Hello, I'm Marc Steiner, and welcome to the Marc Steiner Show on WEAA 88.9 FM, the voice of the community, and on the Real News Network. And it's our pleasure today to talk with Emory Douglas, who is the Minister of Culture in the Black Panther Party, one of the world's noted artists and graphic designers, who joins us here in the studios in Baltimore. He's made another trip through town. Good to have you with us, Emory. Welcome.
Good to be here.
How are you?
I'm doing fine.
You're looking good. Good to have you here. Okay. So I want to take a step backwards, because a couple of assumptions I don't want to make. One assumption is that people even know who you are or who I am, so let's not make that assumption.
Okay.
So I want to go backwards a bit. You were born in Michigan.
Yes.
Way before the Panther Party, before you joined the Black Panther Party.
Oh, absolutely.
So give us a little rundown of your life, because you moved to the Bay Area with your family.
In 1951.
When you were a kid.
Yes, when I was a kid. And I moved to San Francisco because I had asthma as a child. Uh-huh. And the doctor thought the weather would be better in California. And my mother had a sister who lived in San Francisco.
Okay.
And so that's why we came to California. And when I grew up in San Francisco, particularly all over different areas of San Francisco. I went to school there, high school, somewhat high school, but was incarcerated as a youngster.
You went to juvenile prison, right?
Yeah, but I always say as that and other activity that I was involved in, it was because it was illegitimate activity that wasn't sanctioned by the state.
Okay. Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So what? So how old were you when you went to prison as a kid?
Juvenile. I went when I was about 13, 14 years old, gambling with the older guys.
Just like shooting dice or something.
Yeah, shooting dice. Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
And they busted you and put you in jail for that.
Oh yeah.
So. But then something happened. I mean, you were in prison for a while, and then a transition happened somehow in your life where you went to college and started studying graphics. And
yeah,
in
the process
like?
Of being in the detention centers, youth detention centers, I used to like to draw, and I used to do a lot of abstract drawing, nothing that relevant to any type of figures or social issues per se. And so, but when I decided to go to college, my mother, who was legally blind, ran the concession stand that was at the juvenile center, because these were concession stands that were run by the state and they for people who were handicapped.
Huh.
And so she used to run that particular concession stand.
Your mom?
Yeah.
While you were inside?
Yes. And so that's why I knew everybody who was ever in there, because she knew everybody who come to visit folks and stuff. And so what happened is that the counselor realized I was going to college, and he told my mother, she maybe suggested I would take up art.
Uh-huh.
When I went to talk to the counselor at San Francisco City College, the counselor told me to take up commercial art, as opposed to fine arts or something like that.
Right.
And when you take up commercial arts, you learn the figure drawing, you learn lettering, you know, all the pre-press operations, design, all those elements that go into filmmaking, all that. You get a basic understanding in all those things at that time. And so it was San Francisco City College was considered one of the best junior colleges for the arts. And they're always comparing their work to what was being done on a professional level,
mm-hmm.
and always competing with the four-year colleges, the art institutes and what have you, in relationship to the quality of work that was being done.
So that's where you got involved in politics first?
Is that yes, yeah. Well, first I got there because when I went there, this is the beginning of the Black Conscious Movement, the Black Power Movement.
Right.
And you have young Black African Americans all across the country beginning to find themselves, Stokely Carmichael, H. Brown Bounce, SNCC, and beginning to change the names of the Negro Students Associations.
That's what they call
Blacks,
it then.
Yeah, to uh-huh. the Black Students Associations.
Right.
And so that was one of the first things that happened when I went to City College. I was involved with that there. And you were called communists, everything else, simply because you wanted to define yourself and your organizational name and whatever.
But you weren't a revolutionary yet.
No, I was becoming more aware, more conscious,
right.
Yes.
Uh-huh. So was it around that time that you also met, is that when you met Huey Newton and
well,
the rest
of first
became?
I got involved going out to San Francisco State, because it was about 15 minutes away.
Mm-hmm.
And they used to have all the Black arts and cultural activities go on there, because they were the second Black student union in the United States that was formed at that time.
At San Francisco State.
San Francisco State, yeah.
Right.
And they used to have Emory Baraka, Stokely, Sonia Sanchez was out there,
mm-hmm.
Ed Bullins, all those playwrights and stuff were out there. And so I used to go out there for the cultural activity. And when they brought Emory Barak out there, then known as Leroy Jones,
right.
I asked to do his props for the, you know, backdrop, simple backdrop.
Design them.
Yeah, design them, yeah. And so he agreed. And so I was doing that in the Black Arts Movement. And in the process of doing that, there was activists who were also out of state who knew of the artwork I was doing for the Black Arts Movement, flyers and things of that nature. So they called this meeting and wanted me to come to the meeting in regards to bringing Malcolm X's widow to the Bay Area to honor her. And they wanted me to do the poster for that event. And so when I went there, they were talking about some brothers coming from to do possibly do security mm-hmm. to the next meeting.
What year was this?
This is January 1967.
Okay, right.
This is about 3 months after the Black Panther Party had started, October of 1966.
Right.
And so that week when they came, next week they came over, that was Huey Newton and Bobby Seale and little Bobby Hutton. They came over and had agreed to do the security. It was after that meeting that I knew all along that's what I wanted to be a part of.
What was it that pulled you into that?
Because of the high levels of frustrations, the police abuse rampant across the country, young black African-American men being murdered and brutalized.
Mm-hmm.
You had over 300 and something rebellions by that time
right.
across the country in the United States. So all this and the bigotry that you confronted with and the whole bit and was going on. So therefore, respecting, had this amazing respect for Dr. King. But as young people, some of us felt that we want to do otherwise.
Right.
Yes.
Push a little harder, be a little bit more militant.
Yes, yes.
Right. So I'm curious, this is a little digression. How did you not end up in Vietnam?
Well, I never wanted to go to Vietnam, really.
I didn't either.
I never wanted to go to war. I used to
right.
listen to my uncles. I used to listen to all of them talk mm-hmm. how when they were in Germany and all the stuff that they had to go through it while they were in the service. And so I never had wanted to really go into the service. I remember my when I was so bad as a youngster prior to turning adult that my mama used to say, "Boy, go down and get you going to service. Get you some training." And I used to go to take the test, but I used to always fail it.
On purpose.
On purpose. Then one time I went and I tried to fail it and I passed it. But I got a hardship because I told him I had a bad toe and the whole bit.
He believes you?
Well.
So here we are in 1967, and you're starting to align yourself with the Panthers and kind of enamor of their work. And this is very early in the beginning of the Panthers. It was a small group.
Yes.
who was starting out.
Mm-hmm.
So what was your introduction to that? Let me step back for a minute, because I think mm-hmm. a lot of people heard the name Black Panther. And like I don't make any assumptions here as well, they hear about the Black Panther Party. They may have heard UEP Newton's name and associated with all kinds of things. But most people don't really understand what the Black Panther Party was, what the heart of it was, mm. what drew the Emory Douglases of the world to the party, and what it meant
mm-hmm.
at that moment in time,
yes.
in 67, yes. 68.
Yes. Well, it was one because of mentioned previously was regards to the police abuse those young people were confronted with across the country. It was one of the driving forces of a lot of people wanting to do something. And here you've seen this organization of young people like yourself who are out there beginning to put together an organization that began to people seeing just on the superficial level of just the visual of them. Became attracted to that organization and wanted to be a part of it. That with myself was one of my guiding reasons for wanting to join, because they believed in self-defense, which is a constitutional right. The Second Amendment of the Constitution gave you the right to bear arms. And they had it, and they carried that out in a organized and manner, a very disciplined and very organized manner. And that was the first phase of the Black Panther Party. But there's also the phase of dealing with the social programs, the political solidarity, the political aspect of things that we were in international politics as well.
So, but the Panthers were, I mean, people see the Panthers as a revolutionary organization, not just
yes.
kind of a civil rights pushing for change group.
Mm-hmm.
It was a revolutionary organization.
Yes, it was basically human rights, international human rights.
Right?
Yes.
Uh-huh. And talk a bit about the inside. I know that everybody inside when they joined was not a Marxist, but Marxism played a role.
Oh, absolutely.
In what the definition of that party and the people in it.
Yes.
Bobby and Seale mm-hmm. and Huey Newton and the rest.
Yes. Well, they were able to communicate it in a way that, like not speaking in a dogma way, but speaking in a way that even the child can understand it. So therefore, it transcended better because by leading by example, putting into practice what they were talking about, having the political education classes, breaking it down to the cadres and the party, made it, therefore, people were able to communicate in a way that was relevant to the environment in which they came out of.
So, I mean, being in the Black Panther Party at that moment, again, I just want to get a sense that kind of the visceral, emotional kind of feel of the moment, because I think people don't realize what was going on, the sense of a revolution and why people felt solidarity here and across the globe, and especially inside the Black Panther Party, which was targeted, and many of your brothers and sisters were killed. Mm-hmm. I mean, not so much jailed, but murdered and mowed down by the police. Mm-hmm. So that's what you're in the middle of.
Yes, yes. As we evolved, you get around 68, 69, yes, Billy Bobby Hutton was the first Panther who was murdered.
Right.
2 days after Dr. King was assassinated. Memphis, Tennessee. You had the murder of John Huggins, Al Prentice Carter on UCLA campus, January 1969. Then you go on to December, where you had on December 4th, you had the murder of Fred Hampton, Mark Clark
in Chicago.
4 days later, you have the 16-hour standoff and the 5-hour shootout in LA. So there was a concerted effort to destroy and discredit the Black Panther Party in its very infant stages of the organization, because they've seen the impact that it was beginning to have on young people across the country, African Americans, but it was transcending that. You had others who were beginning to become inspired by what we were about. You had the Red Guard, which were Asian Americans.
Right.
The E.Y. Kung, which were Asian Americans. You had the Young Lords, Puerto Ricans. And you had Young Patriots who were
in Chicago.
In Chicago.
The Appalachian white kids.
Yes, yes. And we've been making solidarity with SDS, Students for Democratic Society, opposed to the war in Vietnam. So here we are making these alliances and beginning to become a very force, even though we are maybe be a speck of dust in the context of everything, we were a force within that context.
Right. Yeah. Well, Emory Douglas, this has been a huge honor to see you once again in Baltimore.
It's my pleasure to be here. I'm glad to be here.
And coming to the Real News Studios here to do this for Real News and for the Marc Steiner Show.
Right.
We'll be linking to all the places they can see your artwork and even more. Former minister of Culture of the Black Panther Party from the beginnings almost until the end of the party, and has never stopped his work. Thank you so much, Emory Douglas, for coming by our studios.
Oh, thank you.
Good
glad to be here.